So a bit over a month ago at Google Cloud Next, Google started to talk about the concept of agents. And quite a lot of people, I think, were probably disappointed in what they actually showed after they'd sort of talked about that, you know, they had agents coming and stuff like that. Most people, myself included, thought that this is going to be something along the lines of LLM autonomous agents in here. But actually what it turned out to be far more was the old definition of agents, and this would be conversational agents. So I think what they showed at Cloud Next really was a set of conversational agents that were developed, I think, by the Dialogflow team or some of the other teams in Google Cloud for things like, you know, customer support, dealing with a variety perhaps of different conversations and stuff like that. This was something that, while it was interesting that they showed some of these things really didn't live up to the agents people wanted. Now, they also showed some things with LangChain. They also showed some things like that. But I think most people were perhaps a little disappointed with the sort of agent offerings that Google was showing there. Jump forward to Google I/O, and we see that now Google again is talking about agents. Though this time it definitely seems that the agents that they're talking about are more the kind of agents that we're interested in, of building sort of autonomous LLM agents with various models and tools and abilities and things like that. So talking to some of the Googlers around Google I/O, one of the things that they said that was very interesting was that even amongst people at Google, it was very hard to get any sort of agreement of a definition of exactly what an agent is. And this is something that I think lots of people are still debating about, exactly what is an agent, what are the parts to it. Now, Sundar did go through some of these things on the main stage in the keynote. So he introduced the concept of agents. He talked about them having reasoning, planning, memory. All of these things are things that I certainly would agree with. And then he also talked about the idea of the ability to think multiple steps ahead. So they're not just doing one task and being done, that, you know, there are multiple steps to these things. And then finally, he talked about work across software and systems. Now, I would say that's where they're talking about using tools and that kind of thing in here. So it was very interesting that in the keynote, sort of Google decided to put this definition out there of what an agent is and then proceed to show what they were thinking about this. Now, I did find it funny that one of the key things is they didn't use autonomous in there. Perhaps that didn't test very well. In fact, actually, underneath here, you can see that they've got this under your supervision thing. I guess that certainly protects them from one of the biggest challenges that people are having with agents, is that they're just not reliable enough to do a lot of tasks fully autonomously. This is an interesting step from Google. Now, Google talked about the agents being things that you could use in various different situations, various different kind of places and stuff like that. Overall, it seems that they're very bullish on different places that you could use this. One of them being something that they didn't refer to, which was Google Duplex, which premiered, I think it was in 2018. I was at I/O that day when it premiered. And while people were blown away from it, there was a big backlash against them having bots pretend to be humans and do things on your behalf. And in many ways, that was like a sort of early version of agents back then. Google ended up scaling that back, from what I understand, and they perhaps still use it to check on open times for businesses and stuff like that. They certainly didn't implement it as much as they had originally intended. I think a lot of that because of the backlash, and I think in some places, they were even forced to disclose when they made the call that, okay, this was not a real person making a call. This is an agent on behalf of Google who's doing it for someone else. And my guess is that the challenge that they had there is that those agents were built in very closed domains, that you would have like one that could make a restaurant booking, one that could make a haircut booking, that kind of thing. Now, when they were operating in those closed domains, the fact that they were pretending to be the customer or a representative of the customer allowed them to benefit from the whole sort of thinking of the customer is always right. So therefore, people tended to just go along with them. And if the Duplex agent got something wrong, it could just repeat itself or clarify, that kind of thing. and there weren't any issues. My guess is that once you disclosed that it wasn't actually a human, you lose a lot of that benefit. And perhaps people don't want to speak to the agent. Perhaps they want to ask, hey, you're Google, why isn't my website ranking better for this particular term or something like that? They want to go off topic. And that's something where the conversational agents for a long time have fallen apart, where they can do very nice closed domain stuff, but not open domain stuff. But it does seem that Google is coming back to this to look at doing things for people. So they gave a whole example of someone who's just moving to a new city. They want to do a whole bunch of things like change their addresses on different websites. They want to find out information about the new place that they're living, all those sorts of things. Things that, you know, that they showed as use case for these new version of agents in there. And you can see here, they show that like it's automating sort of browser things. It's automating a whole bunch of different things of perhaps going to various businesses, putting in information, updating information. And you can think about it that actually in many ways, this is where Google has a big advantage. If you're using Chrome, they've got a lot of your passwords saved already. They've got the ability to automate Chrome to do some of these things. So they're able to basically autonomously go through and do these various tasks for you by using an agent in here. So this was a really interesting display of what they were showing in here of the different tasks that you could do. And they chime this in with the sort of one of the themes of their overall, you know, conference was making AI helpful for everyone. So the idea being here that, you know, that if Google allows you to do these things can basically run in the background. It can help you a lot for this. So the next example of agentic behavior that they showed was the concept of Project Astra. And I must say, this is, you know, very impressive. So in the keynote, they talk about this as being a universal AI agent helpful in everyday life. And the idea is that it can take both your voice and some kind of vision in and then be able to use that to answer different questions about what you see, about a whole bunch of different things and tasks that it can do. And you could say they got scooped a little bit by OpenAI on Monday, showing a lot of similar sorts of things, although perhaps a little bit different in that you couldn't annotate specific things. You basically just have video and you have like voice there. But on the whole, generally the same. Now, I've had a chance to play with Project Astra, and rather briefly, I can tell you that it is very impressive what it can do, that you can have conversations with it. It can see, you can ask it a variety of different questions and stuff like that. It can interact with you. Said, I will say that it's still very much a research project at Google at the moment. It's not something that they've got about to roll out. And I do feel that perhaps they did make this look like it was a product that was about to come out to Android very soon or something like that, where I think you'll find that it's actually quite a while off before Google rolled this out. Now, it may make its way into other products. A lot of people were very excited when the person put on the glasses and that thinking that, okay, this could be something that brings back Google Glass. There haven't been any announcements about that, but I do think that's definitely quite possible that Google is looking at how to do things in the light of Meta having their own AI glasses out there, Apple having the Vision Pro out there. Don't forget, it's, you know, quite a long time. I think it's 2016 when Google Glass got first introduced. And as someone quite senior at Google once told me, that Google never actually throws anything away. They just go and put it on the shelf to recycle in some new product going forward. And if you think about things like Google Lens, a lot of those things appeared in sort of Google Goggles and other things in the past. So the Astra stuff is definitely, you know, interesting to see where it's going. And the idea of it having a sort of memory that you can basically ask it things and stuff like that in its context is actually quite cool in here. So when they showed it running with glasses and stuff like that, I think this certainly got a lot of people excited to see, were they about to announce something like Google Glass coming again, but that didn't come, unfortunately. Now, another thing that they showed, which is not directly agents, but certainly is agentic behavior, is the ideas around planning and multi-steps in there. So they show this idea of planning in search, of where you could ask it to do something like find me a meal plan or make me a meal plan for the next week. And it could plan things out in doing this. That's something that, again, is this agentic multi-step kind of thing going on here. They also had a very nice example of where you got various query rewriting. They showed an example of where this woman wanted to basically fix something on a turntable. She didn't know what the name of the parts of the turntable were, and she didn't know exactly what to do to get it to work. So she basically said, hey, look at this picture of this. Tell me what it is and like, how do I fix it? And so you've then basically got a multimodal search or kind of doing a multimodal search to find out different things. And then my guess is under the hood, you've actually got quite a bit of query rewriting there of where you've got one step to actually say, okay, what actually is this thing? Okay, it's a turntable arm. I'm not sure what it's exactly called. And then what could be wrong with it? And if you look at the demo, it's quite nice how it puts it all together to get this. So this would certainly make things like search much more intelligent. And this is one of the things that companies like Perplexity and You.com are doing when they're doing various sort of research agents or research sort of agentic behavior kind of things going on as well. The final one I'm going to talk about, which I think was perhaps one of the most interesting examples of agentic behavior and Google's attempts at implementing agents, was this whole idea of having an AI teammate in Google Workspaces. So the idea here is that you create this AI teammate, you turn it on, they talk about giving it a description and then giving it jobs and interactions. You could think about those as being sort of various system prompts and context prompts for it. And then once they've got it set up, it basically just sits in the chat like a normal person would, and you can interact with it like a normal person would. So in this example here, they basically called the AI agent Chip, and then they ask it things like to do different summarization tasks, or ask it, okay, what was the feedback about their IO presentation? And it will go off and do searches, etc., and do this. Now, one thing I found very interesting was for a lot of these sort of tasks where it goes off, it's not real time where you're sitting there and waiting. It will basically go off and do it and then come back and tell you when it's done for that. Now, I think that actually shows to me that this is something that they've put quite a bit of thought into, to realize that you don't want the user just sitting there waiting for a response, that you want them to be treated more in some ways like a human or like a workmate, where they're going to need some time to do the task, but they'll get back to you. Now, obviously, being an AI agent, they're going to get back to you a lot quicker, perhaps, than a human would in here. But they show a number of nice examples in the keynote of using this agent to do various tasks. And here we've got a whole bunch of things like summarization, going through various proposals, spreadsheets, slides, etc. Now, if you think about it, they're using the Gemini 1.5 Pro million token context here, or perhaps 2 million token context here. So they're able to basically put in all the relevant information, messages, a whole bunch of different things like this into this context, and then prompt it and get it to then basically maybe make multi-steps to find different things, perhaps even do some kind of RAG over that, bring things back, that kind of thing. And I definitely think this is one of the sort of more interesting implementations of agents, of where it's sort of like a digital or AI workmate that you can actually get it to do different things as you're working in a shared kind of space in here. I don't think Google's rolling this product out straight away. I think it's coming in the near future. It's going to be very interesting to see actually how good this is and what tasks you'll be able to give it for doing these kind of things. If we're interested in making agents ourselves, it really does shine a light on some of these nice behaviors of how you could build a product that incorporates some of these things. You've got to think that if Slack was quite smart, they would be trying to implement a lot of these sorts of things. I'm sure you'll see Microsoft Teams do a very similar kind of thing in the not too distant future. And it's going to be really interesting to see, okay, how can people do this sort of stuff? How well does it work? What are the upsides? What are the downsides, etc.? It's really only when these things hit, you know, the road with real customers, trying them out, doing real tasks, doing real things, that you actually get to see, okay, what are they good at? What are they not good at? What do people actually really want to use these things for? And this is one of the things that continually I find myself talking to people about, okay, if I can build you an agent, what are the things that would really help you to reduce the amount of time that you take to do various things here? So anyway, this sort of just wraps up what Google's sort of take on agents was from the Google I.O. keynote and from some of the things that they showed at some of the presentations at Google A.O. and talking to various Googlers and stuff there. I think it's a very interesting direction that they're going in. I think it's going to be really interesting to see how reliable these things are, how they end up actually getting used by end users, all those sorts of things. So as always, if you've got any questions or comments, please put them in the comments below. If you found the video useful, please click like and subscribe. And I will talk to you in the next video. Bye for now.